Hello everyone, welcome to my channel Physics of Funda. I am going to start a full course on tensor analysis. This is the first video of that course. In this video, I shall discuss what is tensor, the transformation rules between the coordinates of different inertial frames, Einstein summation convention, and the representation of Kronecker delta in tensor analysis. Hope you will like the video. Please watch this video till the end. If you like this video, please share this with others. And if you are new to my channel, then please subscribe my channel and press the bell icon for future notifications. Let's start the video. First, we have to know what is tensor. Here the definition. Tensors are natural and logical mathematical representation of physical laws which are invariant with respect to inertial frame of reference. This is the definition of tensor. A tensor is a mathematical tools to represent physical laws which are invariant with respect to inertial frame of reference. To understand this, first we have to know some mathematical definitions such as spaces of n dimensions. Okay. What is that n-dimensional space or spaces of n dimension? In daily life, we see three-dimensional space. In that case, to represent a point, there are three coordinates needed. For Cartesian system, those coordinates are x, y, z. For spherical polar coordinate system, those coordinates are r, theta, phi. And for cylindrical coordinate system, those are rho, phi, z. If we need n number of coordinates such as x1, x2, x3, dot, 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 xn, then the space is n-dimensional space. We consider that kind of space Vn. Okay. Now, we consider another set of coordinates in the same space such as x1 bar, x2 bar, dot, 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 xn bar. The first set of coordinates, it is noted that there is nothing above those coordinates, but in the second set of coordinates, there is a bar in each coordinate point, each coordinates. So, first set of coordinates is often termed as unbarred coordinates, and the second set of coordinates often termed as barred coordinate. Both set of coordinates are chosen in the same space Vn. Now, what is the relationship between these two set of coordinates? Here is the relationship. The unbarred coordinate system denoted by xi, I running from 1 to n. That means xi is for x1, x2 up to xn. Depends upon the value of I. The unbarred coordinate system is denoted by xi and the barred coordinates are denoted by x bar alpha, where alpha also running from 1 to n. That means x bar alpha resembles x1 bar, x2 bar up to xn bar depending upon the value of alpha. Here, interestingly, the numbers 1, 2, n are noted as superscript, not as subscript. This is the representation technique for tensor analysis. So, we follow that technique. Now, what is the relationship between barred and unbarred coordinate system? The unbarred coordinates are the functions of barred coordinates, and the barred coordinates is also the functions of unbarred coordinates. such as xi. This is the unbarred coordinates. This is function of barred coordinates. That means xi is the function of x1 bar, x2 bar, xn bar. Vice versa, effect barred coordinates x bar alpha is also function of unbarred coordinates, such as x bar alpha is function of x1, x2, xn. These two relations are called transformation of coordinates from one frame of reference to another. This is the important relationship to understand tensor. In future mathematical aspects, these relationships are quite handy. Now, we consider one transformation relation xi, which is the function of barred coordinates. That means xi function of x1 bar, x2 bar, xn bar. If we do partial differentiation, then we get dxi. What is that? Dxi is equal to del xi del x1 bar dx1 bar plus del xi del x2 bar dx2 bar and so on. The last term is dxi del xi del xn bar dxn bar. So by partial differentiation, we get this relation. Here we see that the barred coordinates are repeatedly coming from 1 to n. So, here is a summation over alpha. Summation running from 1 to n. And we write del xi del x bar alpha dx bar alpha. So, by partial differentiation, we get this result. Similarly, if we consider the other transformation relation, then we get the second result by partial differentiation. What is that? Dx bar alpha is equal to summation over I is equal to 1 to n del x bar alpha dxi in del xi into dxi. Here alpha is also running from 1 to n. These two relations are quite handy to understand contravariant and covariant tensor, which we discuss in the next video. Interestingly, unbarred coordinate system, the superscripts are denoted by Latin letters I, J, K, L and so on. But in case of barred coordinate system, the superscripts are denoted by Greek letters such as alpha, beta, gamma, etc. These are few mathematical notations before we proceed towards the deep analysis of tensor. Now, another interesting fact, Einstein summation convention. What is that? Whenever an index appears repeatedly in a term, then summation should be implied over that index. This is Einstein's summation convention. Let me show you the fact. Here dxi is equal to del xi del x bar alpha dx bar alpha. Alpha, this index appears twice. So, summation is implied over alpha. Summation is occur over alpha. According to summation convention, if we don't write this summation sign, then it also assumes that summation is done over alpha, because alpha is arrived here repeatedly. That's the Einstein summation convention said. So, if we write the previous equation according to Einstein summation convention, that is dxi. What should I write? If we omit the summation sign and place the rest of the equation like this, this also as good as correct. Because alpha is the repeated index here, so summation is implied over alpha. If we see in the previous slide, then we see that summation is done actually over alpha. So summation convention is right. Again, if we see the second equation, dx bar alpha, what we got? That summation over I is equal to 1 to n. If we see the what is right written between in between summation sign, del x bar alpha del xi dxi. So here I is the repeated index. So summation is implied. Summation over I is implied here. If we omit the summation sign, then it also implied that summation over I is done here. So according to Einstein summation convention, we can write the second equation as this. J dx bar alpha is equal to del x bar alpha del xi into dxi. Here we omit the summation sign because I is the repeated index, so summation over I is implied. Now what is the limit of the summation? Limit remains the same, such as that is 1 to n. We consider n dimensional space, so n number of coordinates, so limit remains same. In that case, summation over alpha is implied and limit is 1 to n, and in that case summation over I is implied and limit of I from 1 to n. Now, what this index called? Here I appears once, but alpha appears twice. And in the second relation, alpha appears once and I appears twice. What this index called? If an index appears repeatedly, such as in first equation alpha and in the second equation I, those index which appears repeatedly in a term, then those index are called dummy index or umbral index. Those index appears repeatedly in a term. In first equation, alpha appears repeatedly, so alpha is the dummy index in the first equation, whereas in the second equation, I appears repeatedly, so I is the dummy index in the second equation. And what about the index which appears just once? Those index are called free index. If an index appears only once in a term, then those index are called free index. Such as in first index, I is free index, first equation, and in the second equation, alpha is free index. If we consider the Cartesian coordinates xyz, then we see that xyz are independent of each other. Like here, x1, x2 up to xn, all these coordinates are independent of each other. So if we take derivative of x1 with respect to x2 or some other coordinates, then we get the result 0. In general, we can write this dxi dxj is equal to 0 if I not equal to j. But what about if we take derivative of xi with respect to x1 with respect to x1? In that case, we get the result 1. So dxi dxj is equal to 1 if I is equal to j. Now, if we consider the mathematical definition of Kronecker delta, what we get there? We get Kronecker delta ij is equal to 0 if I not equal to j. But if I equal to j, then that Kronecker delta comes out to be 1. Now, if we compare these two set of relations, we can easily say that delta ij should be equivalent to dxi dxj. That's why in unbarred coordinate system, we can say delta ij is equal to dxi dx. Similarly, if we consider barred coordinate system, there x bar alpha are independent of each other, like xi, x1, x2, x3 are independent of each other, x1 bar, x2 bar, x3 bar, xn bar are also independent of each other. And if we proceed like this, previous way, if we proceed, we get delta alpha beta is equal to dx bar alpha dx bar beta. This is the expression of Kronecker delta in barred coordinate system. These two expressions of Kronecker delta in unbarred and barred coordinate system respectively quite handy if we quite handy for problem solving in tensor analysis. Now we see alternate expression of Kronecker delta. Okay, xi are the function of x bar alpha. At the beginning of video, we got this. So, by partial differentiation, we can say that dxi dxj is equal to del xi del x bar alpha, del x bar alpha del xi. By partial differentiation, we get this. Because xi is the function of barred coordinates x bar alpha. Now, dxi dxj, what is that? This is Kronecker delta in unbarred coordinate system. So, in unbarred coordinate system, we can write the expression of Kronecker delta like this. Similarly, if we consider barred coordinate system, in that case, expression of Kronecker delta, delta alpha beta like this. What is that? Delta of alpha beta is equal to del x bar alpha del xi into del xi del x bar beta. This is the expression of Kronecker delta in barred coordinate system. These are two alternate expressions of Kronecker delta in unbarred and barred coordinate systems, which are quite handy for problem solvings in future. Thanks for watching this video. If you have some queries or comments, then please feel free to write those comments or queries in the comment section below. Your comments will definitely help me to improve my future videos.